All right. Welcome back, everybody. Sport Chat 503. Thank you guys very much for watching. First time, long time. Either way, I appreciate it. Coming to you live from Portland, Oregon. Man, we are fired up. We're breaking it all down here. Just got back from Los Angeles. One of the greatest events to go to in sporting is the Rose Bowl. It doesn't matter, even just college football, just any sporting event. The Rose Bowl is just a different deal. It's just crazy. The sun setting, you know, the temperature change for both usually universities coming from the Midwest, for Portland, you know, just it's just an amazing time. So such a great time with all the Duck fans. Man, oh man, oh man, we had a great one. And this game really lived up to it. Pretty much what I thought was going to happen happened. Defensive struggle, a lot of turnovers caused by defense, not really sloppy play, but just a, for some people, not that great of a game aesthetically, because they like to see a lot of scoring. They like to see that, you know, greatest show on turf type of football. And this just was not it. This was much more smash mouth, grind it out, 3 yards cloud of dust type football, although there were some wrinkles in it that were pretty interesting. So this game, you know, was just, and again, a big one. And Wisconsin is a great team. I saw a stat talking about the teams that have won the most in the decade, and Wisconsin's right there with Oregon. You know, we're just below that first tier of Ohio State and Alabama, and we're just on that next tier below it. So as Oregon fans, as Wisconsin fans, we had a great time in Los Angeles. Got to be down there for about a week, really enjoying the sights and everything. And everywhere we went, ran into Wisconsin fans, had a great time chatting them up and, you know, wishing them luck. I always try to kill them with kindness a little bit. There's some, a lot of guys, they look at you like they're going to fight you a little bit just because you're wearing the other team's colors. But I always try to go up, shake the hand, you know, say, hey, good job, you know, great year. And anytime you're in a bowl game, you know, that other team has done quite a lot to get to that position. It's not just an average run-of-the-mill type game. This is a team that has done what they needed to do. And again, this year in the Big Ten, a little different because Ohio State went and Penn State had such a good year, Minnesota had such a good year, that it felt like Wisconsin somewhere in that second, third, even maybe fourth best team in the Big Ten at certain times in the year. And no slouch at all. I think Wisconsin's a great program, great team, and we knew what they were going to do. So really impressed with Justin Herbert. Again, local kid. You knew going into this that he was going to run the ball more. You saw it in the big or in the Pac-12 championship game, and then you saw it in that CFP game. And I mentioned it in one of the last videos I did before I went down to LA was looking at Trevor Lawrence and seeing how he was running the ball at Clemson. And this is a similar type of deal. You don't have to have the greatest athlete to be able to get on the edge and run. You just have to have the defense set up for it. And it really was really impressive to me how Oregon took advantage of that. The O-line played great. Really liked the O-line this year, you know, across the board. I think it's really important just to kind of give a face to a name. And I feel like this year, because you had those seniors, you got to know that offensive line. People could actually kind of relate to that. I think average team, the O-line is unknown. Okay, this year, you know, you have Penei Sewell, who we knew last year because he was such a great freshman. And then this next year, he's going to have a humongous amount of pub. You knew Jake Hansen because for the most part, for the last maybe 10, 15, 20 years, the center is a really important position, and the center is somebody who most fans know, whether the is young or is a returning player, most fans know the center. And then you have some great guards. Dallas Warmack comes over from Alabama, Shane Lemieux, and then Calvin Throckmorton, you know, an absolute horse of a guy. And then Brady Aiello, don't really get a lot of praise from him, but he is just as much a part of this starting line as anything else. And I think it's a really cool thing that they did this year with the tickets and everything. They put him on there instead of having Penei on there. Penei will have his time. But I think the idea that you have this redshirt freshman, these guys were here for 5 years. They played a lot of football together. They have a lot of cohesion. And that's just the, how this Mario Cristobal team is built. And I think Mario's all in. I think you can see the energy he has. I don't think he's going to be tempted by the Miami hammy jobs of or anything else that's going to come his way, because you know something's going to come his way. I think he's going to be able to maintain a pretty good coaching staff or consistency on the coaching staff. And I think just the sky's the limit right now. I think this team's on the rise. Running back looked good. Cyrus was in early, but nobody, you know, we didn't really see that many players off the bench. You didn't really see Travis Dye that much. And obviously, we knew Jalen Redd wasn't playing for a personal issue, but tight end was an interesting one as well. You saw Ryan Bay a couple different times. Didn't really see Spencer Webb too much. So it felt like in this bowl game, they went right to the end. They went right for their seniors. They went for their glue guys. Hunter Campmeyer had a wild game. Dropped the first pass to him that was a crucial pass. Dropped the last pass to him, which was even more crucial pass in the fourth quarter. Caught some in the middle that were important as well. Got some big first downs for the Ducks. And then got a really big play close to the goal line. But, man, oh, man, he had some great blocks. If you rewatch the game, I'll be posting my footage of it here shortly. And if you watch some of the highlights of it, man, he did a great job. They would pull him and have him be the kickout block and use the tight end that way. I think it was a really smart thing for offensive line to be able to kind of utilize that tight end in a different type of fashion, like Stanford used to do. I think you're going to see that for Oregon in the coming future. Wide receivers, man, having Micah Pittman back was a big deal. I mean, he's just a spark of energy. He's a guy that's willing to go across the middle. And a lot of wide receivers aren't just willing to go across the middle. He's got a different edge to him. And he had a couple really, really big plays, especially late fourth quarter catches that kept the chains moving that were really, really important. Obviously, Juwan Johnson has the first catch of the game, has the last catch of the game. You know, just an absolute stalwart. If he would have been healthy in that Auburn game, I seriously think we win that game. Having the lack of wide receivers in that Auburn game really showed up. I've watched, rewatched that numerous times since it happened, and I just keep going back to the fact that if we had just a couple more of those wide receivers healthy in that game, could have been a difference, man. And Johnny Johnson III, steady. You knew what you're going to get from him. It's just, you know, it's just one of those deals where I think the wide receivers, you're going to have more talent coming in. I think the future of this program is great. You know, having Josh Delgado, got to talk with his family for a little while. You know, these are the kind of guys that are going to be game changers for us in the future. Defense, though, was really where this team has hung its hat all year. Offense has been pretty much game manager stuff. Offense has been underwhelming at times. I do think Marcus Arroyo did a pretty good job opening up the playbook at the end of this game and getting that win. But for the most part, people have been disappointed with the offensive struggles a little bit. But defense has really been great, you know, and you got to tip your cap to the defense. So Brady Breeze, Javon Holland, both these guys could have got co-defensive MVPs, but Brady had just unbelievable plays. The special teams play on the punt was unreal. Having the ball, one, just the fact that these balls in this Wisconsin thing don't go anywhere. You know, that 2012 game was literally won by that fumble. And then this game had the same sort of situation, but that kick or that punt, it was like a punt error. It was like a flub. You know, he just drops the ball and it just sits there. You know, in any other situation, it's kicked off somebody else, going somewhere else. And if you rewatch the replay, the Wisconsin guys really don't see it. They go off on the punt block. Only a couple guys look back at it and they're like, oh my God. And they get back and they almost beat him to the end zone. But Brady getting that was absolutely epic. That was just one of the best plays. And to have it happen to him, couldn't have been a nicer kid to have it happen to. Again, related to Chad Cota, legendary in the University of Oregon. And, you know, grew up going to these games just like a Justin Herbert, you know, and a really important player for this program and a big recruit as well. So, he gets to come back another year. How fantastic is that? But I think Javon Holland played really well, great tackles in space, really got good rush on the quarterback when he came in on blitzes, and just very impressed with the defense. Obviously, Kayvon Thibodeau, he was trying to get that one more sack to get over 10, and he had it, literally had it, and then the quarterback threw it, but they didn't call intentional grounding, and the quarterback got the ball out in time, and there was a receiver supposedly in the area, but man, oh man, oh man, this was a guy who was all over the place. They lined him up over the center. Their center is the number one center in the country, award-winning center, and KT is standing up. on this guy. Doesn't even give him the opportunity to get the leverage. He gets leverage as he's standing up. And again, if you guys have not played offensive line or defensive line, you know, low man wins, you know, unless you're strong enough to just climb over somebody, swim, move over somebody, rip through somebody if you're strong enough. But for the most part, you got to have some leverage. This guy is standing up. He's not even low, and he's able to get up underneath that center and lift that center and make some moves on that guy. Also, he's able to disengage and make a guy miss, you know. And not to try to relate anything of my past history, but I played high school football. I was a basketball player my whole life. And when I had never played football until I was in high school, my first couple of years playing football, when I played defense, I was like, God, this is so easy. Because I was a basketball player. I would just put a spin move on a guy, post a guy up real quick, put a spin move on him, go in there and tackle the quarterback. I was like, God, why is nobody else getting all these sacks, just racking up sacks? And this is the situation with Kayvon Thibodeau. The guy is so athletic. He looks like a basketball player out there. These guys' offensive linemen can't hang with him. The average offensive lineman, pretty hefty dude. They don't really move that well in space, side to side. They move pretty good for their size, but you take a guy like this and you overextend a little bit, he spin moves off of you. There's no way you're getting him. And that's the future of that defensive end position. Very, very flexible guy. You can put him in the middle. You can put him on the outside. You can drop him off in coverage. I mean, this is a very, very unique player. And as a true freshman, okay? So sky's the limit with this defense. Jordan Scott, really stalwart in the middle. Just steady Eddie. The guy makes great plays, and he's always around the ball. When they're running the ball, always around the ball. One of the biggest reasons why they've had such a good run stop is because of guys like him in the middle. You have to have those guys. Falalu, all these guys in the middle, you know, you have to have these guys. If you don't have these guys up in the middle, you're done. You know, and that's what happened in the old days with Chip Kelly. Everybody wanted to have this great offense. I get it. But then we couldn't stop anybody up the middle, especially. They'd run wild on us through the thing. So defense was a big deal. You know, my dad used to always say, if this team gets a defense, watch out. You know, and it happened, you know, and this is a year that it was just, it all came together. Troy Dye, obviously, is a big part of that. He was right in the middle with all those, fumbles. They had four fumbles or four turnovers. I count 21 points off of turnovers. Crazy. Go down and get the first score, turn it around and get a kickoff return coming back. There's wild. Herbert, right off the kickoff return, throws an interception to a lineman or a linebacker close up on the line. Then they stop them, get the field goal. Huge, huge play. And then, you know, you got to give some credit for them, you know. That Quintez Cephas, man, he had a great day. Jonathan Taylor, pretty good day. Doesn't get over 100 yards, though. Oregon did a really good job of stopping him. And I think his most effective plays was not even really in the running game. It was out of that passing game. They leak him out, throw it right over the top, and we had a really tough time catching him in space. You just got to give credit where credit's due, man. This is a good team. These were both good teams. They both were pretty solid. You know, those fumbles were wild coming off that fumble. You know, you didn't really get that much off of some of them. Some of them you did. That interception was crazy. Forcing the ball out of the hand quickly. Putting a lot of pressure on the defense. Just an amazing, amazing game. The field goal at the very end instead of the touchdown in the fourth, that was huge. And, you know, that fumble, turning that fumble into a touchdown at the very end for the Ducks was just massive. You know, it was like pretty much right away. Got that fumble, turned it right around. Herbert runs in for his third rushing touchdown, which is crazy to think about. And then you had at the very end a very controversial play with this pass interference, offensive pass interference. And I've got it on my view. I've got a great view of it from my seat, got a great angle, and it's totally pass interference. You know, the wide receiver comes straight down. He's blocking basically 5 yards off the ball the whole time, right in front of the ref. And the tight end slips right behind him and catches the ball and gets a first down. Great play, right? Well, yeah, except for the fact you can't block on a pass that far down the field. And that was really dangerous, man. At the end of the game, needed that one. I don't think they'd necessarily go down to score. I still think Oregon could stop them, but that was a wild, wild one. So just can't say enough. Thank you guys so much for the support throughout the year. I'm going to go through some other videos. I'll recap some of the other Pac-12 stuff, recap some of the other college football stuff as well. But wild day. Got up. early, took the plane out, then just got done watching the Ducks get beat by Colorado. Oh my God, basketball, what the hell's going on there? So kind of an up and down one, but man, thank you guys again. Appreciate you guys so much over the whole year. This was a great year. Thank you guys. And all the people that I saw at the Rose Bowl as well, man, it was really awesome seeing y'all. All right, guys, see you guys next time. Sports Chat 503. Adios.